You know, the new covenant, we can start the message now, let me switch here. The new covenant has to do with, as soon as I'm on, the new covenant has to do with leading, not law. Amen?
Amen?
See, a lot of people think that you know, the Holy Spirit and works together with the law, but he really doesn't. He leads you. Amen? He guides you into all truth. Which I'm going to talk, you know, something I want to say as I kind of head this way. First of all, God's always talking. Did you know that? The question is, are we listening? And you have ears to hear. And now I want to say this about the voice of God. It's not, Chris. Yes, Lord. You've been watching too many movies, okay? It's an inner knowing. It's a witness. If you're born again, God is talking to you. And what he does is he confirms the word of God in you, which I'm going to get to that, why it's important to have the word of God in you. And the word in light of the new covenant. What do you mean by that, Chris? As it points to Jesus Christ and what he's done. I heard a story I shared at breakfast yesterday. It really blessed me. This guy, he was somewhat of a rascal. And he thought his wife was losing her hearing. So he walks, she's laying on the couch, and he stands a distance away, and he says, "Can you hear me now?" No response. So he backs up and gets a little closer and says, "Can you hear me now?" Still no response. So he backs right up to the couch and says, "Can you hear me now?" And she says, "For the third time, I can hear you. What do you want?" The moral of that story is God's always talking, but are we listening? Amen? And you know, the effort, because everybody always asks, and I say this a lot, everybody always asks that, under grace, what do? Right? Isn't that the common question? Well, if Jesus did it all, then what do? We simply respond to what he's already done. And that does take effort. Because we're so used to responding to what we think. We're so used to, well, somebody just tell me what to do. Amen? And a lot of times counseling, when people want counseling, you'll bear witness to this. A lot of times they already have their answer. In fact, if you're born again, there's nothing wrong with getting advice. Please don't. I believe in advice from godly people. But a lot of advice you can get can really mess you up. Amen or oh me, right? You know, my point is if you're born again, the Holy Spirit lives in you. And if he lives in you, he is telling you and directing you. You have a knowing, a witness. And if when somebody tells you something that's contrary to where the direction that God is leading you or drawing you, it'll go against that witness. God, and let me say this, God is not schizophrenic. You know, the thing about God is we always speak to the mountain, speak to the mountain. Many times the mountain's us. That's why God told him to move it. It's funny, but anyhow, it's our you know, pride and our thing of what we think we know. And the key is the more we look at Christ, this is what I love about the new covenant. It's not about trying to get rid of the dark. It's not about shoveling the dark out of the room. It's about focusing on the light of the new covenant. And the light is so much greater than darkness. You know, people say, well, when's revival going to occur? I'll tell you when revival is going to occur. First of all, he already poured out his spirit. Revival is already here. Revival will begin to manifest, that's a better way to say it, when the grace message, the gospel, the finished work, whatever terminology, redemption, whatever terminology you want to use, when it begins to get in our walk, guess what? Revival manifests. See, when so many people, and I've been saying this a lot, so many people, they get a hold of the new covenant, they get a hold of grace, and they think, wow, I'm not under the law. And then they run, wow, I... Jesus did it all. He's not condemning me. I don't have to be sin conscious. So we run wild a little bit, right? But then when we get a hold, man, I do what I want to do. You know what I want to do? I want to serve the Lord. I love him. Amen? That's what I want to do. And you know, he'll tell you, hey, don't do that, but there's consequences. I told a guy last night, said, what we've said before, God will never leave you, but your wife might. Amen? Okay? So, but if you really get a hold of grace and it begins to get in your walk and you have that relationship, this is why it's so important. And that's why I thought Kip's testimony is so powerful. Do you know he had to have a relationship with the Word of God? You know, it's like, well, God, if you want me healed, I'll be healed. God's already paid the price for his healing, your healing, my healing, every healing. But you got to have a relationship with the Word of God. You know, sometimes we get involved in religious activity, but we don't ever have a relationship with the Word. It's kind of like a woman that wants to have a baby. She can pray. She can fast. She can do all these things. But if she never has relationships with a man, guess what? She ain't going to get pregnant. You know the Bible calls the Word. Let me show it to you. I didn't mean to go here right away, but we're going. 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 23. Let's just look at this. Hallelujah. Well, in fact, go, before you go there, go to King James, go to Luke 8:11. I just want to show you this. That's good, though, too. Man, thank you for hitting the Amplified. We're coming right back there. Go to 8:11. There it is. Now, the meaning of the parable is this. This is Luke's account of the parable of the sower. The seed is the word of God. The seed is the word of God. What are you saying, Chris? Here again, people say, well, what do I have to do? You don't have to do anything. You're saved. You're in the family. I don't have to have communication time with my wife. Amen? But guess what? If I don't have communication time with my wife, I'm not going to understand why she threw the skillet at me. It's a joke. It's not going to be a good relationship. You understand? I was thinking the other day, and I'm telling different people, every now and then we'll do a breakfast over at Buffalo Jack's. And yesterday was so fun. There was like 8 people. It wasn't a huge group, but just talking the word. See, originally it was a He-Man Woman Haters Club, but we've allowed women in since in Christ there's neither male nor female. But it was a lot of fun just talking the word. It was just fun. And I told my wife, I said, do you know what I came home, I said, I discovered something. When I first became a Christian over, 25 years ago, and I remember hanging out with people, and we would street witness, and everybody was all excited about the Lord, and of course, law and mixture got in there, and people went their own way, and all this stuff. And it was really exciting at that time. And like when you're a little kid, and life was really exciting. And it just seemed like that faded away. Everybody kind of went their own way. But you know what I noticed yesterday? I told my wife, I go, that's back. I go, that excitement, that's back. That excitement of people getting together and just talking the word, it's back. I said, this is really cool. I like this. The difference now is I don't look to people for my life. He is my life. See, I'm not sucking my life out of somebody, or because they can't fulfill only the inside. Only He can do that. Amen? But see, it's important. The more we have a relationship with the word, here's my point. Let me back up. I was thinking about people that are born again, but they never, the Bible talks about fellowshipping one with another. Iron sharpens iron. Malachi, 3:16, then they that feared the Lord, new covenant worship, spake often one to another, and the Lord hearkened and heard it. A book of remembrance was written before Him for those who feared the Lord, worship New Testament, and thought upon His name. In other words, God writes it down. He thinks it's cool. You know what I'm saying? And I noticed that people that, you don't have to do anything, but you get to. And it's exciting. This walk is exciting. I'm having more fun than I've ever had in my life. And that fun's available to everyone. They go, man, I don't know. You don't have to do anything. Well, I'll never get married again, bless God. Well, you don't have to do any of that. But I'm saying there's rewards. Amen. Here's my point. You don't have to do anything, but you get to. You don't have to have a relationship with the Word, but I'm telling you, the more you have a relationship with the Word, the more it will reproduce in your life.
Amen.
So the parable of the seed is the Word of God. Now go Amplify, if you would please. 1 Peter 1:23. Look at this. I'm glad you hit the Amplify. That's wonderful. We've had a little software situation, so this makes it great. I got to say this. These guys that do the scripture verses, Bob and I did, they're amazing. I was thinking about it the other day. Could you imagine me doing scripture verses for me? It says, you have been regenerated. Now, I got to say this to you. I said I do correct myself. Sometimes Michael does it, but then I just get away. I get a kick out of Michael. You remember Seinfeld? Hello, everyone. Hello, Jerry. Well, me and Michael are like, hello, Michael. Hello, Chris. Or I'll walk away, Michael. It's funny, I don't care who you are. It says, you have been regenerated. So I'm going to correct myself here. A while back, I made this statement and said that I'm becoming a believer. That's incorrect. I am a believer. And so are you. Now, here's what I meant, though. Okay? You have to, sometimes things are semantics. In other words, I'm realizing more and more what I believe. But it's important to understand that you're not becoming a believer. You're already a believer. You already is. See, all we're doing, Paul prayed in Ephesians chapter 1 that the eyes of your understanding would be enlightened. Or the Amplified says that the eyes of your understanding would be flooded with light, that you may know. Know what? What is the hope of your calling? I heard somebody say that recently. Nope. The hope of His calling. The hope of His calling. That you may know what is the hope of His calling. It's His calling. See, I'm getting a little different. I gotta move on. You have been regenerated, born again, not from a mortal origin, seed or sperm, but from one that is immortal, by the ever-living and lasting Word of God. Amen. So here's the point. When you have a relationship with the Word, guess what? There's a conception that takes place. And eventually it's going to reproduce in your life. But if there's no spiritual relationship with the Word, there will be no conception. And if there's no conception, you'll never realize what you have. If you're born again, you're born again. Amen? But it's so vital. I can't stress this enough. Let me read this to you. I love this. I read this the other day, and it just really blessed my socks off. Now, I got to say a few things here. This is an old-timer by the name of E.W. Kenyon. Now, E.W. Kenyon has been greatly criticized by meatheads. Some of them are Christian meatheads. Most of them are. Is he perfect? No, he was a man, but he was mightily used of God, and I highly recommend his books. Amen. Okay? See, because if you're going to, well, don't they say he was this? Let me tell you why they say, no, I'm not, because I'll get on a whole subject. Come Thursday night, we'll eventually get into it. Did Jesus die spiritually? Yes or no? That whole thing. That's one of the reasons he's criticized so much. But anyhow, listen to this. This is from Two Kinds of Righteousness. I just thought this was amazing. Do you know, I got to say this. Some of the most miserable people in the world are Christians who have no relationship with the Word. They're born again. They're going to heaven when they die. All that stuff. But if you don't have a relationship with the Word, I'm telling you, if you're trying to pull your life from outside here, there is no life here. But if you're pulling it from Christ in you, the hope of glory, see, the Bible says be filled with the Spirit, Ephesians 5:18. It doesn't say be filled with the senses. Be filled with the Spirit. Now, senses are great. I love good feelings, don't you? And your walk in the Spirit, well, sometimes we feel the presence of God. That's wonderful, and I love it, but you know, sometimes you don't. How many people feel American today? I don't know what it feels like. Oh, I guess I do. You're American, whether you were born in this country or you become a citizen, you're an American whether you feel like it or not. See, the point is feelings are good, but feelings are bad if they're leading you. Because feelings can fluctuate. How many of you know what I mean? How many of you know sometimes you ever just all of a sudden just feel depressed for no reason? Just feel blah. Why? Because it's gloomy out or something like that? Now, I've heard that in the Northwest, Washington, Oregon, that suicide rate is higher because it rains more there than anywhere else in the country. And so it's gloomy a lot. That somebody told me it's like the sky just leaks all the time. and because, why? See, because this is why it's so vital that we're Spirit-led. What is faith? Faith is acting on the Word. Well, I don't feel like I have joy. You do. Doesn't matter what you feel like. Hallelujah. If you'll act on it, guess what? You'll feel it. I don't feel like the guy that said, his wife said, hey, honey, get up, it's time for church. I'm not going to church today. He said, you have to, you're the pastor. All right, listen to this. The urge that makes one man a drunkard, another a philosopher, the restlessness that fills the dance hall and the gambling resort, the roadhouse and the movies, he died in 1948, so bear with the terminology, and all the other places of pleasure is the heart's search for reality, that universal quest of the ages, the Spirit's search for the Holy Grail. No one finds it until they contact the man, Christ Jesus, and crown him as Lord of their life. That moment the search ends, they have survived. They may not be conscious of what it is, but they know that the pleasures that they once sought have lost their taste and attraction. They did not know that the hunger was spiritual, that it was a search after something that only God can give. You know, a lot of times people that overeat spiritual hunger. A lot of times people don't understand that. A lot of times it's spiritual. You know, I've discovered that I have this desire to sneak and seek all the time. To go pray, ask my wife, where's he at? He's gone. He's out in the garage, sitting in the van, praying in the Holy Ghost, or reading and meditating while he's praying. That's a desire. It's the Holy Ghost in me. Come, fellowship. I want to show you things. I want to talk to you. Amen? That's the way it is for all of you. Whether you recognize it or not, that's the way it is. So get full of the Holy Ghost and do whatever you want. Some of you heard that. I'll say it again. Get full of the Holy Ghost and do what you want. Now you have the Holy Ghost in your spirit, but he says be filled with the Holy Spirit in Ephesians 5:18. What does that mean? I've always asked myself, if I've already got him, how can I be filled with who I already got? Good question. And in the Greek, it's a commandment. Present, passive, imperative. means constantly allow the Holy. It has the idea of control, letting the Holy Spirit control you. Passive means receive it, and imperative means it's not an option. I need to be. What does it mean? It means to allow the Spirit to direct you into the Word of God. So you see, I'll tell you the problem. Some people, oh, the devil's a problem. You know the devil's defeated? Do you know the devil can't do anything to you unless he's got a vessel to do it against you? Don't say the devil took my car. He can't take your car. Now, he can speak in the ears of someone that's yielded to him to take your car. But he can't come and directly do anything. He's a spirit. That's why they said send us into the pigs. Well, that's good news. He can't come at you directly. Demons are defeated. Amen. Amen. Three amens. That's great. Hallelujah. They're defeated. They're afraid of you. Hallelujah. Well, let me just read and finish this. No person reaches the place of rest in the Spirit until they have made that contact. Amen. Amen. Until it moves past the realm of theory into the realm of reality. And what is that? That just has to do with your focus. Amen. People say, I don't feel this way. Excuse me. Well, change your focus and you'll change your feelings. My wife and I, we talked about this one time. And we were talking about, well, I feel this, well, I feel that, but what are you focusing on? Amen? See, you focus on the promise. You have a relationship with the Word, and guess what? It conceives, and eventually it's a reality. It manifests in your soulish realm and into your physical realm, just like Kip was talking about with the miracle. I mean, notice he said they were listening, and they were consuming, and they were listening, and they were relating to the Word, and speaking the Word, and talking the Word. Not to get God to do anything. He's already done it. But they were renewing their understanding, their mind to what Christ had already done. Then all of a sudden one day, wow, I really believe this. Hallelujah. See, it's called relationship with the Word. Being intimate with the Word of God. And then eventually manifest. Do you know, I'm going to say this to you. Well, I'm going to put this down for now. Go give me Ephesians. So much for notes. Ephesians chapter 4, 3, verse 14. We'll just go there. Hallelujah. Ephesians chapter number 3, and look at verse 14. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Can I have it in the King James, please? Thank you. For this cause, this is Paul, one of Paul's prayers, of two prayers in Ephesians, Ephesians chapter 1 and Ephesians chapter 3. This is powerful. For this cause, I bow my knees unto the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, next verse, of whom the whole family in heaven and earth is named, next verse, that he would grant you, according to the riches of his glory, to be strengthened, watch this, with might by his Spirit in the inner man. I've told you before, the word strengthened means literally invigorated, filled with energy. You know, I made a decision. I know some of you might laugh at it. That's okay. Sorry about that. I might have to use my water there. But I was in the nursing home the other day. Thank you. Let me get a drink. I'm going to have to quit smoking. Just kidding. There's nothing wrong with, I mean, smoking's bad for you. It won't say anything. It'll make you smell like you've been there, all that stuff. Whatever. It's not the point, you know. You can overeat, just don't smoke, right? Just kidding. Where was I? I messed up. Yeah, I was at the nursing home, right? I'm like, I'm back here now. But you know, I told my wife, I visited there yesterday, and I was walking out, and I see some people, and basically, it's no way to live. You know, it's just not. I said, I'm not going to age like that. I've just made, the Bible says he satisfies my mouth with good things, that my youth is renewed like the eagles. That is no way to exist. You know, and you know, and it's not God's plan. You know, God loves everybody, no matter where we're at. But see, we have authority. We're going to get into this. We're going to talk about the name of Jesus, and that's where we're at, hallowing his name. We're going to talk, you know, you have authority in the name of Jesus. See, some people, even when Peter walked by and he said, silver and gold have I none, but that's because he gave it all in the temple. That's what I heard a preacher say. But silver and gold have I none, but such as I have give I thee in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise and walk. You know, he didn't even say like, well, I wonder if I have enough faith. I better use my faith. He just knew that God gave him the name. Do you know we make things too complicated? We're always concerned about having enough faith. You got enough faith. I said this Thursday night. I go, do you know it's unscriptural for me to tell you as a born-again child of God to have faith in God? Now you're looking at me in a cow in a gate. I'm going to explain myself. Jesus said that in Mark 11, 22. But you know that was before the cross. Amen. That was before the cross. Jesus said, have faith in God. I'll show you in the new covenant. We have the measure of faith, Romans 12, 3. We have the same spirit of faith. We have believed, therefore we have spoken. 2 Corinthians 4:13. Peter, 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 1. We have obtained like precious faith. You've already got faith. You literally have the faith of Christ in you. If you're born again. If you're not born again, you don't. The good news is you can be born again. Amen.
Amen.
But see, it's unscriptural for me to tell you to have faith in God. Now, I know some people say, well, that means have the faith of God, all those types of things. Because Jesus was talking to people before the cross. See, when we talk about the Lord's Prayer, which we've been talking about, we talk about how really our Father who art in heaven after this manner pray is primarily an old covenant prayer. Now, there's new covenant concepts in it, but he's transitioning them from the old covenant to the new covenant. Think with me for a minute. Israel had been under the Mosaic law for 1,500 years. That's a long haul. See, that's a long time. That's a long time. So he's transitioning them from the old covenant to the new covenant. When Jesus spoke what we commonly call the Lord's Prayer in Matthew chapter 6 and Luke chapter 11, that was before the cross. And that's why in Matthew's account he said, after this manner pray. And he's transitioning them from the old covenant to the new covenant. If you don't understand those things, I promise you one thing, you will be confused. That's why I've said many times that years ago when I would read Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, I always wondered why I felt condemned at certain parts. Am I the only one? I read them because, man, I was disciplined and diligent in reading my Bible, but I didn't understand why it seemed like it condemned me, like I never measured up, like, well, I don't know if I'm doing that. I don't know if I'm doing that right. I'm not bringing everybody into my home. I'm not, you know, except you hate your father and mother. You ever read that? Luke 14, 26? Well, it's a comparative term. Well, I agree, but it's strong. A violent choosing of Jesus, on it goes. But he's saying, he says, you got to live to such a high standard under the law that no one can do it. I heard a preacher say this yesterday. And I played it for my wife, because we can go back on our IPTV. And I played it for my wife. And he was talking, let me give it to you. Well, we're going to come right back here. Say, we're coming back to Ephesians 3. All right, I want to show you this in Luke 1:17, and we'll come right back here. I heard a preacher say this just the other day. Here's what he said. He said, and he shall go before, referring to John the Baptist, before him in the spirit and power of Elias or Elijah, to turn the hearts of the fathers to the children, and the disobedient to the wisdom of the just, and to make ready a people prepared for the Lord. And this guy actually said, God is looking for a people who will walk in the spirit of Elijah. Wrong, wrong, triple wrong. Elijah was an Old Testament prophet who called fire down from heaven. Remember that, Luke chapter 9? 55, 56, 52 through 56, Luke chapter 9. James and John, they didn't receive Jesus. He said, hey, you want us to call fire down from heaven like Elijah? Jesus turned around and rebuked them and said, you don't know what spirit you're of. The Son of Man didn't come to destroy men's life, but to save them. That's why when the church gets up and says, these are the days of Elijah, I want to puke. Yeah. Honey, get the bucket. Just turn it off. That's what I do. These are not the days of Elijah. These are the days of the new covenant. They're the days of Jesus.
Amen.
See, the days of Elijah is calling fire down from heaven. This guy actually said that. And I thought, my, oh my, is it any wonder the church is messed up? You got, it's one covenant or the other. And see, and that's why I say, if you don't understand when Jesus walked the earth, that it was before the cross. And he was relating to old covenant people. Amen. It'll mess you up. That's why the church is such a mess. See, it's what you don't know won't hurt you. What you don't know is could kill you. Now back to Ephesians 3, quick, verse 16. Ephesians chapter number 3, verse 16, and let's look at this. That he would grant you, according to the riches of his glory, to be strengthened, invigorated, empowered with might by his spirit in the inner man. How are we charged up? Let me say this to you. You know, I see, you know, revival meeting, or you know, come to our church. Well, that pastor can juggle. Nice! I told the joke here about the guy that was, he was a juggler and he was going to perform his act and he got pulled over and the cop made him, he said, what is that? He goes, this is for my act. Oh, no, it isn't. Well, prove it. So he's juggling those knives. So he's juggling these knives and the guy dressed up, man, I'm glad I quit drinking. Look at what they make me do now. Man. something like that. That he would grant you according to the riches of glory. So here's my point. Strength comes from within. If you're born again, the Holy Spirit lives in you. Let's get out of this debate.
Well, do you have the Holy Spirit?
If you're born again, you have the Holy Spirit. You cannot be born again without the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
It's impossible. Amen. Not by works of righteousness, Titus 3:5, which we have done, but according to his mercy, he saved us by the washing and regeneration and renewing of the Holy Ghost. Amen. So you're strengthened with might by his Spirit in the inner man. And it's important here again, when you get into the Word, it's not, you're getting in the Word to see Jesus. Okay? That's new covenant. But the Holy Spirit will empower that. And you'll see things. Like, I think I said it last week, I'm driving down the road here, and this sign down the road that said, if you're coming this way, you're heading west, it has Proverbs 28:13. It says, whoso covers his sin shall not prosper, but he that confesses and forsakes them shall have mercy. And I'm just driving along, and all of a sudden it hit me. New covenant, I saw it. If I attempt to cover my sins in my own strength, I ain't going forward.
Come on.
I need a sacrifice bigger than me. Hello, Jesus.
Amen.
For by one offering, Hebrews 10:14, he has perfected forever, them that are sanctified or set apart. That's you. That's me. Glory to God. Kind of goes right in line with Proverbs 14:9. Fools make a mock at sin, but among the righteous there is favor. I used to think, fools, sin. That's not what it's saying. The Hebrew actually says, fools mock the sin offering. It's picturing the new covenant. See, everything points to Christ. Everything points to Jesus. Glory to God. Okay, so it's his Spirit that strengthens me with might by the inner man. Here again, not understanding this is what causes problems. Next verse. That Christ may dwell in your hearts by faith. Now this is powerful. Wiest, who's a Greek scholar, says it like this. That Christ might finally settle down and feel completely at home in your hearts. Now I used to think that he just doesn't feel comfortable in my hearts because look how I act. You know what I say, if you get your act together, it's still an act.
Amen.
Never forget that. It's still an act. But that's not what he's saying. You know what he's saying? You know how Christ feels at home in your heart? When you look to him and not your own self-effort. That Christ, that's how he's finally able to feel at home in your hearts, because you're no longer trusting in your efforts, you're trusting in what he did. Man, I love that. That you being rooted and grounded in love. Now stop. One translation says that you're cemented in love. Don't you love that? Cemented in love. That you being cemented, rooted, and grounded in love. Sometimes if you ever try to pull a tree out or something, or even just a plant, if it's got a massive root system, it can be tough to pull out, right? Amen. So he's talking about we being rooted and grounded in love. Next verse. And let me tell you, he is love. That you may be able to comprehend, understand with all saints. You know, if you're born again, you're a saint. Hallelujah. Look at your husband or wife and say, man, you're a saint. You sure don't look like one. You don't look like a statue. No. You may be able to comprehend with all saints what is the breadth. That word breadth means width and length and depth and height. Of what? Go on. And to know the love of Christ, which passes knowledge. My wife and I were listening to Pastor Reza coming in here, and he said something, whenever you criticize people, you're a loser. You've just stepped outside of the love of Christ. That rocked my world. That doesn't mean you like what everybody does. But you know, I was thinking about his love. Lord, how do you love some of these people? His love passes my human understanding. And that's the love that's in you if you're born again. You know how you walk in love? You just do it. Because it's who you are. I could walk like a meathead, or I could walk in love. I'm just going to walk in love because that's who I am. Hallelujah. So that you may be able to, that you might know the love of Christ, which passes human knowledge, finite human knowledge. And once you know the love of Christ, you're filled with all the fullness of God. Every lack in mankind comes down to this one thing. People don't know the love of God for them. You want to pray something for yourself? I've been praying this. Lord, let me have a revelation, a greater revelation of your intense love for me. That's what you need. So, oh, Chris, that's selfish. No. That's what will empower me. That's where I'll walk in an intense love for you. Amen. See, the enemy, this is why the enemy wants you in the sense realm. Why? Because if you're in the sense realm, then what people do will cause you frustration. And when you're frustrated, you don't walk into who you are. Amen. If I'm walking by my senses, Why did that driver just cut me off? Give him a peace sign. Why do they do that? Why do people act like that? Why do they, you know, all that stuff? You can spend your whole life doing that. And let me tell you why people act like that. They're nuts! So are you, without him. Right. See, well, I think once you realize everybody's nuts, some people's nuts is just more sophisticated than others.
That's perfect.
Can you edit that? No, I'm kidding. Some people's craziness just is a little more sophisticated than others. But see, sanity's Jesus. But see, sometimes the world perceives it as craziness. You know what they said? They tried to get Jesus, I think it's in Mark 3, where they said he's beside himself. Paul, they said, much learning has made him mad, nuts. I'm telling you, it's what we don't know that hurts us. That's why I tell people all the time, you know, grace is not natural. I wrote through this, really. A short time of not hearing grace and you'll revert back to self-trust. Because it's not natural. Nothing in this world is saying grace. Or I should say not nothing, very little. Sometimes your family, and then they'll extend an unmerited favor to you. But even that runs short. Amen? So if I don't hear it, I will automatically revert back to self-trust. That's why he says in 2 Peter chapter 3, but grow in grace, increase in grace, and in the knowledge of God, our Lord, our Savior, Jesus Christ. There's so many things I want to say. Do you know that God is not God to you? He's Father. Can you hear that? Yes, he's still God. Nothing diminished, but he's your Father. Hallelujah. Man, that stuff's good. I got so many things to say. It's hard to say it all. What is man's religion? Religion is that system that makes you trust in your own effort for what's already yours. Religion causes you to trust. Let me rephrase that. Religion causes you to work. That's what I meant to say. Religion causes you to work for what's already yours. I use this example. How foolish would it be for me to try to work to be in this room? I'm already in it. Well, if I don't know it, then somebody just tell me you're already in this room. And see, and that's what the new covenant is. You know you're already perfect. I didn't say your actions or your thoughts. I'm saying, but in God's eyes, as Jesus is, so are you. And I love how he says this, 1 John 4:17, in this world, just in case you misunderstand it. But the less you realize that, the more you act like somebody else. You act like who you think you are. Do you know why I act like an athlete? Because I think I am. Even though reality is screaming at me. I just live in denial. That's a joke for those of you that haven't heard me say all that. I love joking. We used to work with a guy, and he thought hillbillies were a superior race. He did. He just said, you Buckeyes. And he would always criticize his Buckeyes. And he was a pitcher, and he had his belly that went like this. And he would stand over there, and one guy said, look at him. You tell he's an athlete. He'd always say that, I'm an athlete and all that. So that's kind of where I got it from. So, the word, we must have a relationship with the word. And once the word is conceived, that's when it grows. Let me show it to you in Mark chapter 4. Mark chapter 4. Well, Mark 4, we'll come right back here. Mark chapter 4, verse 26, please. I want to show you this. Because sometimes when we pray, if you're sense-led and you pray for, and the Bible says, believe you receive when you pray, if you believe you have, and if you don't see an instant manifestation, if you're led by your sense, you say, well, it didn't work. Amen? Well, when you prayed and got born again, and they told you, well, you're going to go to heaven when you die. Okay, just that. Did you all of a sudden know it? Or did you just take it by faith? Well, it's the same way. It's the same way with everything in the kingdom of God. Now watch this. So he said, so is the kingdom of God as if a man should cast seed in the ground. This is a kingdom principle. Jesus fulfilling the old, many times old covenant, many proclaiming that. He said, this is how the kingdom of God will work. Watch this. Should cast seed in the ground, it should sleep and rise night and day, and the seed should spring and grow up. He doesn't know how. Do you know if you just keep putting the word of God in your life, you just keep having a relationship with the word, all of a sudden it conceives and you don't even know how. And it'll grow. And you don't even know how. In other words, it'll begin to manifest in your life, and you don't even know how. You know something that I'm finding more and more in my life? This may shock you. But I used to feel what, you know, it's been said that most people live lives of quiet desperation. I used to feel that. I don't feel that anymore. I still have goals. I still have things that, but I just feel very content. And I have for last, I don't know how many years. The more I hear about what Jesus did, even though, you know, I have goals and, you know, sometimes things don't go the way you think and all that kind of stuff, you know, your football team loses and I'm kidding. But I mean, you know what I'm saying? But the whole point of it is it's not there anymore at all. There's a joy, an excitement. If you're not excited when you get up in the morning, you're probably not allowing His Word to really take root in your life. Now, please don't be condemned. Be encouraged. Just allow it to take root. I love what Richard said to me yesterday. It was so good. He said, you know, I don't understand how people that are Christians can be depressed. A lot of them are. A lot of them are. But that's why I said the Bible says be filled with the Spirit, not with the senses. And I believe that, you know, if you understand spirit, soul, and body, what the Scripture teaches, I believe depression, and I've shared this before, for a Christian is nothing more than a soul, which is your mind, your will, and your emotions, that is not receiving the life source that of Christ in you, the hope of glory, which emanates from your spirit. That's why it says be filled with the Spirit. Not with the circumstances. Not with what you see. Not with how you feel. Hallelujah. See, and what you see, you'll declare. So many people, well, you just speak the word. There's that, name it, claim it, blab it, grab it. You know where people get off with all that? Is they think just because they say something, that's the way it is. Thank God everything I said never come to pass. I'm just dying to have a piece of pie. Thank the Lord. Amen? There's a safety valve here. Amen? So this is how the kingdom works. It should sleep night and day, sleep and rise night and day, and the seed should spring and grow up. He knoweth not how. Next verse. For the earth bringeth forth fruit of herself, first the blade, then the ear. And after that, the full corn in the ear. In other words, one more. And when the fruit is brought forth, immediately he putteth in the sickle because the harvest is come. Here's what I want you to see. How does the kingdom work? How does it work in your life? First the blade, then the ear, then the full corn in the ear. In other words, you've got it all. But the more you realize you got it all, it will manifest in your life. Just like his testimony that he shared. You know, they were hearing and hearing. And at first it's like, nah, I don't know about that. That's crazy stuff. You know, here. So many people, I love what Andrew says, so many people don't let the Bible get in the way of what they believe. I say it like this, man, I love to think outside the box, but I won't think outside the book. And I'm going to be in there, and I've got to know. You know, and so I'm not going to just take things because even my favorite preacher says it. I'm going to search, I'm going to be a Berean. And receive what people say, but search the Scriptures daily to see if those things are so. Let me tell you what's so. If it exalts Jesus Christ and his finished work, we're on the right path. Amen. Now, I want to close with this. It's so powerful. And why the importance of being one with the Word. First, give me 1 John 5, verses 18 and 19. Quick, please. Sorry. Don't mean to rush you. 1 John 5, verses 18 and 19. I want to show you this. We know that so whosoever is born of God sinneth not, but he that is begotten of God keepeth himself, and that wicked one toucheth him not. Once again, it doesn't mean you never make a mistake, but it means that in Christ's eyes, there's no sin. And some people interpret this as you don't walk a perpetual lifestyle of sin, which I believe if you're in the light, you cannot walk a perpetual lifestyle that's contrary to God. That's not my point. Here's what I'm after. Next verse. First, I'm going to say this. The wicked one toucheth him not. I love that. Does that mean you'll never go through anything? Does that mean the adversary won't have people come against you? Oh, there's plenty. Yeah, I like what my wife says. You know, the devil looks for people to hate you through. I can't understand how anybody can hate me. I'm serious. I can't understand how anyone could hate you. Maybe Ron, but I'm just kidding. I was thinking, who could hate me? Very sad. Innocent. Minding his own business. Ron's actually one of my heroes because he has learned, you know, we've been frustrated how our wives will forget their purse, but not Ron. You ever see Ron? He's so secure in himself, he walks out and he's carrying that purse. I mean, that's a secure man right there. Some of us that aren't as that secure is like, I'm not carrying that. You touch it. So the wife says, we know that we are of God and the whole world lieth in wickedness. Now let me say this to you. The whole world. I used to always think the wickedness is of trying to approach God in your own strength. I always thought it was, well, just the bad things that occur in the world. Yes, that's wicked, but that's really a result of not putting faith in Christ. So here, the Greek actually says the whole world lies in the lap of the wicked one. Isn't that amazing? Now I want to read this to you. Here's what I'm talking about. This really is part of the message of hallowing his name. sanctifying, setting apart his name. I got a lot more to say about that because we're going to talk more about the name of Jesus. But I'll read this from Pastor Reyes's book. It's called One with the Word. Once the Word takes root in us, our mind thinks in accordance with the Word of God. We become one with the Word. We are no longer looking on the outside. We are no longer on the outside looking in, but we become one with the Word. The Word becomes the way we think. You know, your first reaction is how you really think. Think about it. Your first reaction is like, ah! You know, whatever. That's usually what we really think. But imagine when you're so full of the Word that your first reaction is, this ain't nothing for Jesus. Amen. You know, one of the old timers, Smith Wigglesworth, he was so radical that, you know, and here again, not saying you can't have a newspaper in your house, can't say anyone, but he was so radical he wouldn't even have a newspaper in his house. He was just so separated from the Word. And now here again, that don't make him more righteous. Wigglesworth didn't understand everything right, okay? But he had amazing faith. I know we're at the place, some of the commercials will kill you. Oh my. What was Brother Howe saying the other day? We were listening to him. He says they tell you got to have this hamburger, which causes all the cholesterol. Then the next commercial is how the pill you're supposed to take to overcome the cholesterol from the hamburger you got. And the commercial after that is a lawsuit about the pill you took that to overcome the cholesterol. Amen. No way. Whoa, man. Anyhow, but let me just read this to you. It says. The Word becomes the way we think. Take, for instance, scriptures quoted from Romans, and then there's some there. Once these truths become as established in you as well as you know your name, you will no longer struggle with sin. Stuff like sin shall not have dominion over you, for you're not under the law, but under the grace. But under grace. Imagine knowing that as well as you know your name. Oh, you don't have to know the address. That means chapter and verse. Well, what did Jesus do? What would Jesus do? Let's look at Luke 4:17 quickly. I'm wrapping up. Oh, I got plenty of time. 3 minutes. Luke 4:17. Just look at this. And there was delivered to him the book of the prophet Isaiah. And when he had opened the book, he found the place where it was written. Wow. I found the place too. Isaiah 61. How'd you find it? I looked it up. And you can remember, you have the mind of Christ. Where's that at? 1 Timothy 2:16. 1 Corinthians 2:16. Amen. I'm not saying you got to know all that, but I'm saying when you become so much a part of you. Do you know what I've noticed? God is a consuming fire. There's such a desire now to just, he's so awesome. He's not condemned. I don't have to do anything. I can lay on the couch and eat. Well, I can't. I got to go to work. But if I don't want to, just want to eat chicken, you can do all that. But it's not beneficial. The more relationship you have with the Word, the more you see what Christ has done, the more it'll manifest in your life. The more intercourse that you have with the Word of God, the more it will produce in your life. You know, that's how it works with sin. It talks in James chapter 1. It says, every man is tempted when he's drawn away of his own lust and enticed. Then when lust hath conceived, it brings forth sin. And sin, when it is finished, brings forth death. What is sin? Going your own way. That's what it is. See, the world's crazy because people are going their own way. Even people that have it all together many times are living in fear. That's not abundant life. Amen. You become one with the Word. It is no longer theory or doctrine. It is a part of your thinking and your being. The life of the Word becomes your life. The Word becomes incarnate in you. Isn't that what Jesus said? Abide in me and let my words abide in you. John 15:7. Sin had no inroad into Jesus because he was the Word of God. Religion and religious people treat God's Word as a potion. The Word is an outside medicine for them, an outside solution. It's never part of them. They take a portion of it that suits them and toss the rest that contradicts their lifestyles. Here again, please don't hear this as a law you keep. This is a life that keeps you. Do you know God is interested in your well-being? But if I sit there and run out on the frozen lake that's not completely frozen and the sign says, stay off, danger, and I say, I'm not listening, I'm going to do my own thing. If the Holy Spirit's nudging me and saying, don't go out there, it's not safe. God loves me, but I'm going through. Amen. See, this is the key, is becoming one with what Jesus said you are. You already are one positionally, but when it begins to become a part of your experience. See, you can do it every day. Sometimes I like to take good Christian stuff, sometimes the Word, sometimes a Kenyan book or something, just a couple things I'm just meditating on. And even when you're watching a football game, you can just have it there. Nothing wrong with watching a football game, unless it's certain teams. Kidding. See, I believe God gave us sports so we'd have something to argue about. I can't prove this biblically, but my theory is, this is a theory, that he didn't want us arguing over the words, so I said, I got to give him something. I'll give him sports. Football, that's a great. We'll call this team, and on the 13th day, they called it the Cleveland Clowns. I'm kidding. The Cincinnati Bungles. All right. It says, in the New Covenant, God never intended for his word to be an outside guide. Never. In the Old Testament, the people, the word was an outside force that guided for God's people. Their spirit was not born again to contain the word. They had a carnal mind. The word was an outside force. It was a rod, a measuring tool for their lives. In the New Testament, because of the new creation, the word is written and etched by God's own spirit in our hearts. Amen. Jeremiah 31, verse 33 says, I will put my law in their minds and write it in their hearts. The word is near you. It is in your heart. And in Romans chapter 10, once we yield to God's eternal word and live by it, then we become one with it. The word becomes in us. This is the glory of the new creation. The prayer of Jesus for us is that we may understand this awesome truth and live by it. He prays that we may become one with him and the Father as he is one with the Father. John 17, verses 20 through 22. This is God's great plan for the new creation in Christ. Jesus said the Father and I are one. John 10, 30. Can we dare to say that? Glory to God. How great is this new creation? The reason we don't is because of all the false teachings we have received in the church. How can we say we are one with the Father when we constantly sing we are sinners saved by grace? If we dare to make a statement as in John 10, 30, we will be accused of heresy. I understand why. The preachers have been telling us our sins about our sins so much that we are sin-conscious believers. We have sung church hymns and songs about our fears and our failures for so long that our minds are bridled with unbelief. I said this the other day. You know, for you and I to sing I Surrender All is not New Covenant. Why is that? Well, let me say this to you. I cannot take Curtis's coat and give it to you. Why? It's not mine. The Bible says you're not your own. 1 Corinthians 7:23. You've been bought with a price. To say you surrender all is to imply that you haven't surrendered all. When you were born again, you did surrender all. You're not your own. You're bought with a price. I can't surrender something that's not mine. I'm not my own. See, but if you operate like you're still your own, that's the mess. I can't surrender all. I've already done that. I'm born again, so have you. I can't surrender your coat. It's not mine. See how... That's why I appreciate the worship team and how they go through and they make sure that these songs that we're doing, you know, we're really conscious of what we're saying. You know, there's so many songs that'll mess you up. Create in me a clean heart, oh Lord, and renew a right spirit. That's Psalm 51. That's after David committed his sin with Bathsheba and had her husband Uriah the Hittite murdered. Amen. If you're born again, God's put a right heart in you. He's taken that stony heart out of you and put a heart of flesh. Where's that in the Bible? It's prophesied in Ezekiel 36, 26, Hebrews chapter 8, Hebrews chapter 10. Watch this. Ignorance is the mother of all weakness. Wow. Ignorance is the mother of all weakness. I'm about done. I'm trying to finish up. This is so good. I got to get it done. Knowledge means strength. Not just head knowledge, but it starts there. But when you understand, knowledge is strength. Do you know God desires you to operate in no fear? Do you know what it means to be righteous? We've talked about this. The righteousness of God in Christ. You know what that means? No fear. No fear. They can tell you, the Lord can say, hey, I want you to go to this Islamic country where they're killing people and beheading them. Not a problem. No fear. Or am I saying I walk there all the time? I'm not saying I do, but I'm saying that's where God wants me. No fear. What about the future? What about this? Why, if you're the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus, that means you're as right with God as Jesus because it's his righteousness given to you as a gift. You have nothing to be afraid of. He'll never let you hang.
Amen.
Man, that's good news. That is such good news. But see, when we operate independent from God, when we operate out here, and we don't understand that Jesus got his prayers answered. I got to finish, I know. Ignorance is the mother of all weakness. Knowledge means strength. Darkness and ignorance are co-partners. The body of Christ is suffering tremendously today because we are kept in darkness about our inheritance. The religious spirits are feasting on the ignorance of the church. Hosea 4:6, my people are destroyed for a lack of knowledge. There is a cry, a craving, a hunger throughout the world for the manifestation of the sons of God who are aware of their great inheritance. Romans 8:19. There's a cry for a manifestation of you and I as the sons of God who realize our inheritance. Glory to God. You know, people want answers. The enemy's greatest trick has been religion. Amen. Well, I go to church. Then I operate my life. You know, even the mindset of, if you look at clergy and wearing collars, and are you against that? I hate that, to be honest with you. And you look at like the monastery mentality and even the mindset of, well, if you're going to be in the clergy, you don't marry. That's why they have problems with all that sex crap. Thank you very much. Because God gave you that desire and it's of Him. Read 1 Corinthians chapter 7. But it's like, I'm the clergy. And it's all over. So we separate our walk of faith from real life. You ever think maybe the Lord would like to watch that football game with you? As long as He's rooting for the same team I am, we're good. Otherwise, I'm operating separate. You're killing independent Chris! That's a Seinfeld episode. Anyhow. Praise the Lord. You know, God's not religious. He's not at all. He loves you unconditionally. You cannot out-sin His grace. That scares people. That scares religious people. You can't. But if you're really receiving His grace and it gets in your walk, I'm telling you, it's exciting to talk about the Lord. It's Jesus is exciting. Hallelujah. Glory to God. You're one with Him if you're born again. Now, if you're not born again, you're not. If you're not born again, you're one with Satan. But we can change that. You can accept Jesus Christ today. All right, I'm going to end, even though I got 45 minutes. If you've never accepted Jesus, I'm just going to ask you to pray a simple prayer. Just say, Dear Jesus, come into my heart. I receive you now as my Lord and Savior. I thank you that all my sins were taken by Jesus at the cross. All of my diseases, all of my sicknesses, all of my depression was taken at the cross. That you took every negative thing that I deserve because of sin, and you turned around and gave me every blessing that you deserve because of love. In Jesus' name, I receive it now by faith. And everyone said, Amen. Now I'm going to ask you to do something. If you have a sickness in your body, I don't care if it's a cough, I don't care, lay hands on yourself. The Lord has been telling me, practice my power. Practice my power. Boy, I was thinking, my wife and I were talking today about just, you know, Peter didn't even, when he said, such as I have, give I thee, rise up and walk. He didn't think, well, do I have enough faith? See, a lot of times when I pray, I ask myself, well, did I say it right? Am I the only one?
Jesus hears it right.
I got to tell you, I'm going to share this. When Michael and Leslie had their baby, he called them early in the morning, talked to Jen, and then a little bit later I got up. It was early, but I was still up early, and I went out and I prayed, and all of a sudden these fears tried to get on me. Like, what's up with this? You know, what if something, you know. They, 2 weeks early, right? But it was 7 pounds something. I mean, if the kid would have come 2 weeks later, it would have been a toddler. Mike said, yeah, we had a God's little baby. I mean, everything was fine, but I felt all these things. And I thought, well, maybe I should have prayed more. All these things, that, you know what it was? It was putting faith back in me. Amen. I said, no. This is about Jesus. Everything's fine. I give it to you. Amen. But see, fear will attack. And it's based on self-trust. Because that's what makes me fear. Maybe I didn't do something right. Maybe I didn't say it right. Maybe I didn't have enough. See, you got enough faith. That's why I corrected today what I said a while back. You are a believer. You're not trying to be a believer. You're already a believer.